Hello, everybody. Welcome once again to the Legends of League podcast. Now, as you know, we are responsible for the Legends of League tournament, which we have done so successfully thanks to your support over the last couple of years in Newcastle and on the Central Coast. COVID-19 has put a temporary hold to that. Oh, but it will be back. In the meantime, the Legends of League podcast, and we are live at the Four Pines Brew Pub in beautiful sunny downtown Manly. Give it a try for yourself. Four Pines Pacific Ale, the Indian Summer Ale as well. And today on the podcast, a couple of great blokes. Chris Walker, now based on the Gold Coast, and our very own Brett Finch. Let's do it. Well, hello, everybody, and once again, welcome to the Legends of League podcast. Maroon is my name, and I love rugby league just as much as you do. A special guest today, and just before I get to that, we come to you once again from the Four Pines Brew Pub in sunny downtown Manly, where they make the good stuff, the Four Pines beer. Oh, you just can't beat it, and we might have one of those straight after the podcast is finished. Now, my guest today, you might have heard him giggling there, 70 games for the Raiders, just shy of 100 for the Roosters, Parramatta, Melbourne Storm, off to Wigan. He's a colourful identity in the rugby league world, and he's a good mate of ours, Finchy. Brett Finch, welcome.
G'day, Maroon. Jeez, it's dangerous bringing me to a brewery to do an interview.
I was thinking, I said, can't we get...
I might never leave.
Yeah, I said, can't we go into Girdler's coffee shop just for this
Girdler's
one?
Girdler's grind.
He's already had his head under the beer tap, giving himself a beer shower. But, mate, it's good to see you. Good to see you well.
Yeah, it's been going good, mate. It's obviously crazy times with the footy and... everything else in the world that's happening at the moment.
Yeah.
But it's been really good. Spent plenty of time with the family. My little girl was one last week, so it's been exciting to watch her grow up.
Yeah.
It's been great.
She's beautiful, thankfully. She looks like
nothing
your
like
beautiful
me.
Wife. Now, but you are well, because you know what, Finchy, sometimes I call you and you don't call back and I say, is he being a typical footballer? What the bloody hell's going on? Where is he?
Yeah, I can go missing at times. I'm not great on the phone. I know the missus is into me to... carry my phone more or call people back. So I'm pretty poor at that end of the spectrum with the phone. But I've been going good, mate. Everything's going really good. Not at Fox this year, but hopefully now the footy's up and running, I can get myself back in there somewhere working with you, mate. We always have plenty of fun.
Yes. Well, you know what they say about you, Finchy? You get in where water can't.
Yes. So. I'm arthritis, painful, and I'm in places I shouldn't be.
Well, mate, no doubt you'll get a start somewhere. Look, there's so many stories on and off the field about you. I don't know whether we start with Molly Meldrum or we start with Ricky Stewart. I mean, we could be here all day.
Yep.
Why don't we start by using modern technology, going to the Zoom and get one of your old housemates and playing mates via the Zoom. He's another great colourful identity on the Gold Coast these days, where they tell me he runs the place. Chris Walker, welcome to the Legends of League.
Thanks for having me on, guys. Thank you very much.
Now, let's start off, Walks, before we get to what you've achieved in rugby league, and that's plenty as well, but we always hear these stories about you and Finchy and everybody. I think Crocs was one of them, maybe Minnie, always in a certain house in Marivery Road, North Bondi, the House of Grouse. What can you tell me about that, Chris?
Well, Maroon, it's probably the best 12 months I've ever spent in my life. We had the opportunity. I was playing at the Roosters. Obviously left South, joined the fierce rivals in the Roosters. I knew Finchy. I've known Finchy for a very long time. I've known Croc, Toddy Payton, and also Minnie and all the boys, Finchy, all the boys, for a very long time. And I got to the Roosters. Finchy had just signed at the end of 2002. I'd supposed to be at South, but I left and I came to the Roosters. And then we decided to all move in together. And Maroon, if that house that we lived in at Maroon Road, North Bondi, if those walls could talk, everyone's talking about The Last Dance of Michael Jordan. I think this would blow it out the window.
That's a big call, Finchy.
It was the best 12 months I've ever had. It took about 10 years off our life,
but
we trained hard, we drank hard, we partied hard, but we'd always turn up and play, give 100% for the Roosters. And I think, honestly, the reason why we made the 2004 grand final was just on the back of us living together, because, poor old Toddy here was at the West Tigers. Finchy, you could back me up. He'd play on a Sunday and we'd play on a Friday. We wouldn't stop drinking till Monday.
Yeah, we'd have to come home. We'd come home some nights and Minnie didn't really have much regard for anyone else in the house back then. That's when Minnie was on top of the world. Arrogant could be one of them. Minnie have a few beers. It was like talking to a brick wall trying to settle him down. And he would come home and just bring half the nightclub home with him. It'd be Sunday morning. Poor old Toddy, he had to play at Leichhardt that afternoon, and Minnie would crank the music up as loud as possible. It's like, mate, like, we would even be like, give Toddy a break. We've been going for 2 days. Just let him get some sleep before his game. But one night we come home and Toddy had moved the TVs and speakers and everything. He'd hit it all in the house, so we couldn't play any music. But, yeah, it was a tough 12 months with Toddy because the Tigers were pretty poor that year. But the following year he won the grand final, yeah. So he certainly got his revenge on us.
Do you remember what nightclub that was, mate? What was the regular nightclub around Sydney in that time?
Well, so the regular nightclub back then was Good Bar. It was along Oxford Street. It was a Wednesday. The best night was that was Wednesday night. We'd always play on a Friday. I think the first 13 of the first round, first 15 rounds, I think we played 13 Friday night games. So we used to give it a nudge any night of the week. And Wednesday night was a particular good night at Good Bar. I remember there'd be countless occasions where, 3 o'clock in the morning, Finchy and I would be the only ones left at Good Bar. We'd get home and Minnie had brought home 40 or 50 people back at our house just to keep on partying. So there was many a nights that Finchy and I were depressed because we'd never drag anything home, but you'd get home and there'd be 15 or 20 sheilas at the back of our place and they'd be all partying. So the party just kept on continuing when we got home.
You never saw, the old Italian, when Minnie first started, he come from Preston's out wide, he'd just drive a Datsun, he'd have a matching Kappa tracksuit on. Not like the Tom Ford jackets and the Lexus he's rolling around with now in Vaucluse. Mm. So he's certainly come a long way. He used to have the old undercut on when he was younger, but a couple of rank humans like me and Walks would always rely on Minnie. He certainly become better friends with Minnie when he was on fire during those days.
You'd pick up his dregs, and his dregs were 9.5 out of 10, so he wouldn't mind.
Hey, Chris, talk to us about you, how you came to be at the Roosters, because you were at the Broncos, you came to Souths, you're at Souths for 5 games. Souths fans like myself were filthy on you, but you soon settled in at the Roosters, didn't you?
Yeah, I did. I mean, I left the Broncos for the wrong reasons. I was probably thinking with my other head because I was dating a girl down in Sydney and that was taking up a lot of my time at the Broncos. I was coached by Wayne. That put a fantastic offer to me. I was on the back of the 2002 State of Origin series where we won the second one in a row. I think Broncos offered me, I think, $250 plus a car and the lurks and perks living up in Brisbane. But like I said, I was thinking with the wrong head. I chased the money to go to South. I probably shouldn't have left Broncos at that time in my life. I wasn't mature enough to leave the Brisbane and get down there. And it just didn't work out. South offered me all these sort of things, but never delivered. And that was a contributing factor of me leaving South. It wasn't the fact that we'd lost the first 5 games.
That certainly didn't help.
It didn't help, but just, like Finchy, you come from a very professional outfit.
Well, the Broncos were the cream of the crop around that time too, weren't they?
And they were too, mate. Like, we as a young player coming through, you never really worried about too much. Everything was done for you. Everything was done for you, but wipe your ass. When you go away, everything was looked after. And then I went to South and, that offered me all this sort of stuff. I was getting death threats from the fans, which also didn't help.
Now we only get them from the missus, not the fans these days. Just the bride gives death threats.
Mate, the bride's into me all the time. So, I mean, I look back now. I'm 40 years of age. I look back. I wish I could have talked to a 22-year-old immature, brash person about who I was dating and who I was hanging around with, and made that right decision. But I didn't make the decision, and got the opportunity to leave South and obviously join the Roosters. And me coming from Queensland, I never knew the fierce rivalry between the two clubs. So when I left, there were certain areas of Sydney that I didn't want to go down. It's all forgiven now, but they've become a strike force in the comp over the last 15 years, South. So it's a credit to them. But at that stage in my life, it was probably not a good move to leave Brisbane in the first place.
So let me open this up now to both of you. So, in the end, Chris, it was the right decision. You made the right decision. You went to a more professional club, and you're only 22. You've got to be at a professional club when you've got that sort of talent. But then you guys come together. Ricky Stewart's the coach. Talk me through that, because you would have played football with some absolute legends. You've already spoken about Minnie, but what about Ricky Stewart? What about some of the other blokes?
Yeah, it was a tremendous team. Like I said, I got there after they won the comp in 02. Walk sort of come in the start of the following or the same season we debuted, but Walks was sort of round five or round six he come in. So we're both pretty new to the team. They're a tremendous team. They sort of changed the way the game was played at that stage with their rushing defence and the way they gang tackle teams and pick them up and take them back. Sticky was a very intense coach, but they're an extremely hardworking team, as Walks would tell. We trained extremely hard, and while it was the most fun and there's characters who loved to beer and could drink, there's no never anyone shy of going for a beer. When you go for a beer, there'll be plenty of hands raised, but the next day the standard of training was always high, and there was always extremely tough training sessions and extremely tough trainers. I know Freddie was our leader. He was sensational, but other guys like Fitzy and Rico and Adrian Morley, those sort of older guys, Walks, weren't they? They certainly, they led the charge off the field, but they certainly set a high standard when we come to training, and that's why probably the team was so successful.
Yeah, it was successful for a long time under Ricky. I mean, after we lost the 2004 grand final, I think it was Freddie's last game, we went into 2005. With a little bit of expectation, and it sort of fell apart. It sort of unraveled really quickly at the start of 2005. I think there was a bit of a hangover, obviously losing two grand finals in a row, both from the coaching staff, the players, the fans, the board, the sponsors. I obviously got sacked at the end of 2005.
I lasted one more year after you, then I was gone as well.
Yeah, I know, but that's it was a pretty sad ending to what started as a really exciting journey. But that's football. We see it a lot of the times in professional sport, not just rugby league. But Finchy, you're exactly right. We knew where we stood. If we did go out on a Sunday and have a drinking session, we knew that Monday morning, come 8 o'clock, we were on the field, we were ready to go. Sometimes I didn't rock up until 9:30,
one boot on, because I was over from the night before. Mate, you've never seen a bloke. Sticky used to do these four in fives, which was the four laps in 5 minutes. And if one person didn't make it, you'd have to go again. So it was punishment.
Yeah.
Anyway, Walks rocks up. We're rushed down on the field and he's into us. We had a bit of a night. We had the North Bondi rough water swim. So we swam that Sunday, me and Walks, and then we're at Ravisi's, a few of us. And so we've turned up, been hungover. Sticky's got us on the line. Let's do this run. Walks has taken off at the start, and he's flying. Walks is there's not many blokes who are quick and fit, but Walks was quite obviously extremely good short distance speed, but was really good long distance runner as well. So Walks was out in front, and I remember Craig Fitzgibbon looked at him and said, "Look," turning around to us, and while we're running, going, "Is he only wearing one boot?" Walks was still that pissed. He only put one boot on, and he was running. We're doing the four laps in the oval in 5 minutes, and he's got one boot on and had no idea he was wearing one boot. and he got it under the time. He made the time with one boot on. So imagine how quick he would have gone with two boots.
And then Georgie Rose missed the time. Yeah. So he had to do it again. The reason why we did the four and five is because I was an hour late because I was still hung over in bed. And John Cartwright ring me and say, "Mate, listen, you better get to train." And I got to train an hour late. And the reason why we got a punishment of four and five was because I was late. And then George Rose missed it, and I unloaded on him.
not making the time.
He did it was because of me.
Well,
but, they were good times. They were the best. I mean, they're those memories that when you do play sport and you play professional sport, Finchy, you could back me up. Those are the memories that last, and the memories that I still look at that my time at the Roosters as a very enjoyable time. Yeah. So.
Well, Walks, when you look back around, obviously me and Walks played for a lot of clubs, and I can't speak for him, but I've got a lot of friends from all clubs, but still my probably closest and oldest friends are from that period: Walks, Minnie, Croc, Ryan Cross, Rico, Freddie,
Toddy Payton,
all those. Over the last few years, we've all got sort of married, and we might not have seen each other for a while, but, still come together around those times. So like Walks said, does. You're young living in Sydney in the eastern suburbs, and certainly early days the Roosters were flying high. You can create some pretty fun memories.
But you've both got that personality that would annoy Ricky Stewart. So 2002, you win the premiership.
Well, we didn't win it. The Roosters won it.
But then
I'm playing the Broncos. We got knocked out by
2004. So, like you alluded to before, Walks, 3 years in a row you make the grand final, or the Roosters make the grand final, but you lose two of them. And on one occasion, does Ricky not, and we all love Ricky, I'm not having a dig at Ricky, did Ricky not pull you up in the men's and say, you cost me a grand final?
Yeah, no, I said I cost both of them, both grand finals. So looking back, he's had every chance, but I certainly felt in 03, Todd Byrne could have taken some of the blame with me.
me dropping the ball in 2004 from a bomb, you know. I was a part of that team. I take responsibility. I know that, you know, Ryan Cross takes responsibility for those losses, because the thing is about rugby league, you can't blame one player. There's 13 players out in the field. There's four on the bench. We all contributed, plus the coaching staff. No one goes out there to lose a game.
No.
And I was there that night that Ricky had a go at Finchy in the toilets. And I admire Ricky Stewart as a coach and as a bloke, because I get along with Ricky really well. But that didn't sit well with me, because there was blame thrown at me. There was blame thrown at 16 other players, including Finchy. We just had an off night, and we got beaten by two teams that were better on the night. It's just unfortunate.
That's why I look back.
And now we're going to live with it.
Yeah, I look back, and certainly some of the two probably worst games we played of the season, or was it both on the ground. And that just shows, like, when you look at American sports, with the best team's going to win best of seven series. But the beauty of a grand final or a Super Bowl one off, if you don't get it right on the day, 2004 were minor premiers. Certainly the Dogs were a great team there. 2003, we come second to Penrith, and we'd smashed them earlier, at the end of the season out at Penrith, so we're confident going in, but we didn't get it right on the day. And so many times we see teams, Newcastle upset Parramatta in 2001 and things like this. You've got to get it right on the day, and that's the beauty of the grand final or a one-off, and we didn't get it right those days, like Walk said, and that's certainly a bug that's something we've got to deal with.
Chris, you just made a comment then. You dropped that. I remember that bomb. But you just made a comment about you've got to live with it. What are you saying, that these things haunt you? Like 16 years later?
Yeah. 100% they do. I mean, if you weren't competitive, if you just took a loss, in your stride and whatnot, and you didn't have the burn of that loss, well, of course, you're not going to worry about it. But that's something that. And that happened 16 years ago to the day, nearly to the day, and it still burns me. And 17 years ago, we lost to Penrith. That burns me today. Like, I probably maybe a year ago or 2 years ago, I actually sat down and watched both of those games on Fox, because they were on Fox. And for 16 years, I've been beating myself up saying, geez, I had a bad game. But I actually didn't play too bad in both games. There were some tries scored down my side, but, that's going to happen in a game of rugby league. You can't stop some of those tries. And unfortunately, the lead-up work that the attacking team did before they scored those two tries, they sucked three or four players in on the inside of me. So there's not really much that I could have done. But that's sat in my mind for a very, very long time. And, I've had some closure on it, but it still burns me.
It's funny, you can have 100 wins and one loss. Yeah. As a competitive person, that one loss – you can't stop thinking about it, it's just the way, a lot of players are made up.
I tell you what I do quickly. I quickly just fast forward to the start of Origin games where I won.
Walk us on.
But you know what, Chris, you like the Walters boys and the Walkers boys, you had the privilege of playing at the highest level alongside your brothers. Thank God there's only one Brett Finch. But
you don't want any more of me. I've got another brother. He thinks he played at the highest level, Troy, but...
But in your youth, now your old man is a very well known.
Yep.
He's like a godfather rugby league, very well known in rugby league in the rugby league world. I'm old enough to remember him playing for the Dragons. And I think from memory, he probably retired a young man from playing first grade rugby league. Yeah. But so he's gone back into coaching at the Raiders in Newcastle. He's a Maitland boy, and while at Newcastle, you come into contact with John's boys, who are 7-8 years older than you, and they used to stay at your house.
Yeah, well, obviously they were. Andrew was about in the under-19s at the time. Dad really gave Matthew his start in reserve grade at the Knights, and a lot of the times back then, it was really such a good close team. But it was a bit old school. So if you knocked the team off, if the Knights were playing Canterbury and St George needed the Knights to beat Canterbury, they would offer the dad a keg on the Sunday. If we won, so the Knights would beat Canterbury, for the Dragons would give him a keg, and the keg would be tapped at our house. So I'm 7 or 8 years old or whatever. So I'm out the back.
Another piece of the puzzle.
The boys would be
started.
Yeah, exactly. the boys would all be on the drink. Dad's team, and Matty was one of them. But Matthew, obviously coming down from Cessnock, they'd all get on the drink, and he would go out in town in Newcastle And he, you know, his car's, he's been on the drink, he can't drive, his car's out, he's got to get back to Cessnock. He would always just sleep, excuse me, on the trampoline. So usually I had to get up early, me and my brother, to clean up all the empty cups and all the rubbish in the backyard. And one morning I'd get up and I'd come around the corner, I'd seen these legs hanging over the end of the trampoline. And it was Matthew was face down. I didn't know who it was. Matthew was face down and I come running on. I remember just yelling out to Dad, Matty's dead. And he stuck his head out the back door and he went, he's not dead. He's just in reserve grade next week. Or under 20. But we woke him up and sure enough, he wasn't dead, but he was pretty close to it. Yeah. He was quite hungover. And usually because they couldn't get all the way back to Cessnock, you know, they were only young fellas. They didn't have the cash for a taxi. They were just... I'd sleep on the trampoline and sure enough, Mum would make him bacon and eggs in the morning. So there's a method to their madness.
But it was a long way from the trampoline at Maitland to the beautiful terrace house in suburban Melbourne where Molly Meldrum lives.
Yeah, it was. Molly used to have this party there. We wanted a party there for everyone involved at the club, players, girlfriends, staff, football staff, just normal staff, support staff, the marketing side, everyone in their family. So that was at the end of 09. And we'd won the grand final in 09. So we had a drink night Sunday, big day Monday. The party was Tuesday. We're on the drink Tuesday. Frank Panisi comes to everyone and says, listen, I'm real hesitant about this party going ahead because she's all... You know, I don't know why I'd be so nervous about 30 rugby league players intoxicated. But anyway, he goes, yeah, he said, mate, go and have a, everyone, if anyone misbehaves, their contract's torn up. So we go out to Molly's, we're having a great time. Anyway, I go upstairs, I go to the bathroom, I come out of the bathroom, I look in one of Molly's spare rooms, he had all the hats he wears. Now I thought, you know, it'd be a great idea if I'm thinking this to myself. If I take all my clothes off, get nude, put that hat on, grab that storm scarf, grab that storm flag and run down through the party singing the song. And I'm thinking to myself, and I double check myself and I'm like, yeah, rugby league make great decisions when they're intoxicated. History shows that. So I think this would be great. So I get Molly's hat put on, get all my clobber off, put the storm scarf on, got the flag. I come charging down through the party. We are the storm. Past the directors and everything. I'm like, anyway, I run and frog leap over the table of food into his pool in the backyard. Now, I've crashed through the water, and as I've gone in under the water, I've thought to myself, Finchy, you magnificent bastard. You've done it again. You know, you've turned this party on its head. They're going to love it. Everyone's going to be in stitches. And before I've come up through the water, Bellyache's put his hands through the water and grabbed the scarf around my neck and pulled me out of the water. He's pulled me up the side of the pool. I'm dripping wet. And he's going, I told you if anyone misbehaved, they're going to have their contract torn up. Now, someone like me, you'd think, you know, having my career threatened would be my number one thing that was wrong. Well, it wasn't. I looked down and the pool wasn't heated. So the old fellow was like a scared turtle, you know. So I'm sitting there thinking, being a single guy, do I try and save my career? Or do I save my reputation? Because obviously at that time I was single, a lot of blokes' girlfriends were there and I was trying to hook up with their friends, so I had a bit of a reputation. So I've tried to save my manhood and I'm trying to get some blood back in it, moving around and Bellyache goes, what are you doing? Like he was filthy. And Molly Meldrum come from behind and slapped me on the ass and goes, this is the greatest party ever. And Bellyache goes, you're damn right it is, Molly. And they've had a party there every year since. So
that's gold.
Yeah. 11 years on, the tradition continues.
Yeah, exactly. I don't know how many people are getting nude there, but sometimes I rock up there nude and just say, hey, Molly, how are you going? Bit of fun.
Hey, Chris.
I've heard some other stories out about that too, Finchy. But
yeah, I had to leave a bit of it out in between.
Yeah. Chris, we touched on your brothers earlier. They've what are they having, a year off coaching? They've had some success already, haven't they?
Yeah, they've been coaching here in the Intrust Super Cup, the Queensland Cup, for a number of years. They've been out at the Ipswich Jets. We won the premiership in 2015, but they've been there for a little over 10 years now at Ipswich. So this year, they've decided to have the year off. I don't know if they'll go back next year, to be quite honest with you, because I think they're really enjoying, not being coaches of a semi-professional team or a professional team. They did put up their hands or put in their resume to coach the Gold Coast Titans before the great Garth Brennan took over a couple of years ago and took them from 10th to 16th. So maybe they should have gone down that road. But I think that Yeah, they're just enjoying their time. They've got pretty successful businesses, respectively. Ben's got the real estate agents here in Ipswich and up in Toowoomba, and Ben and Shane's got a lay-by company that, you know, they turn over a fair whack themselves. So, they're very passionate about their coaching, and they love their coach. They're just man managers, mate. They've got a good understanding. Finchy, I know that you've got a very good understanding of rugby league, so you don't mind talking to Ben and Shane about football. When those boys got together, I remember at my wedding, between stories about the House of Grouse and everything that we used to do, Finchy, I remember, you know, for about 4 hours, they sat there and talked about football and picked their brains about players. And it was just really good. They got a very good understanding. And like I said, they love their players and they love their man managers. I don't know if they'll ever get a chance to coach in the NRL. Hopefully my little nephew, Sam, can sort of keep the name going for Walkers in the NRL with the Roosters. But I just hope they get a gig coaching in the NRL.
All right. Now, listen, boys, before we wrap this up, I want to have a look. We asked you both, as we ask all our Legends of League, to do a team of their best 17 players of the last 40 years, and you've both put in your team. Now, without going through all the whole team, I just want to point out some of the ones that stood out for me. Now, this is the first time anyone has suggested Adrian Morley, and for you blokes, you've both got Adrian Morley in your best 17.
Yeah, Walks, you want to go first, though?
Yeah, well, yeah, okay. And probably Finchy, I'd say that you'll echo my thoughts. Mate, I had the privilege of playing with Adrian Morley at the Roosters for a number of years. And like Gordon Tellis, who I've also got in the team, when you're a young fella and you sit in the dressing sheds and you're playing football and you're about to go out there and play professional football, a gladiator sport, and you're about to get your head knocked off, or you're about to have your, you know, someone wanting to take your blood, I always had Adrian Morley. You always looked at Adrian Morley as your protector, like I did with Gordon Tellis when I was coming through as a young age. And that's what his aggression, his presence on the team and on the football field was unbelievable. Finchy, you could probably back me up. You'd look across. Now, we had a fierce rivalry with the Bulldogs during that time and a number of other clubs, and you could see. You'd see players, and even when you talked to Willie,
get out of the way. They didn't want to run at him.
They didn't want to run him. And it come. I used to love when we used to, the start of the game, if we kicked off for the start of the game, you knew that Adrian Morley, you'd see him in the sheds, the eyes would roll back before you'd run out, and you knew that he was just going to clean someone up. And it was exciting as an outside back to see that happen. And that's wholly and solely why I've got him in the team. Yeah. I've got Sam Burgess with him at the front row because they're aggressive.
Yeah, he was the first, you know, obviously there's a tremendous amount of great Pommies out here at the moment, but Moz was the first one in a long time, sort of from Ellery Hanley and that sort of gang, you know, in the 80s, you know, when they come out. So, but first one for a long time was Adrian Morley, and he was tremendous at the Roosters. He's probably the most damaging forward in that time, not only with the ball, but without it. And like Walk said, he struck fear into everyone. And as a halfback, it was old school. If someone come out of the line and tried to take me out, you seen what Villasani did to Freddie in 02.
Yeah.
And then Moz cleaned him up. Like, Moz took that personal. And every week he took on their best forward. You know, he made it personal for him. And it was like every week he had to prove he had that reputation. But for us, you know, like Walk said, when you're getting changed and you see blokes like Moz and Freddie and that getting ready, it makes you feel better. You know, well, we've got a chance today because these blokes are getting ready. And certainly with Moz, and Walks is probably in the same boat as me, but probably Walks can hold his hands up a bit better than me, but someone who's a bit lippy and can't really hold his hands up, having Moz there, let me tell you, I become very, very tough and very, very outspoken when I was behind Moz.
Now, boys.
Become a bit brave, some might say, because of Moz.
The other, you've both only got a couple of players still in the NRL, which is fair enough because you're talking about the last 40 seasons. But you both have – another one I wanted to point out is Jason Taumalolo, who is it's not unlike him to clock up 300 metres in a game of football consistently, but he's been out injured. That really affects the Cowboys.
It does, mate. And he's made more metres in one game than I made in 15 years of rugby league. I think we'll look back on him. Again, you sort of look back on people's careers, you know, probably – you know, once you're retired, you've never played a bad game, you know what I mean? But I think Taumalolo, he'll go down as one of the absolute great forwards of our time when he's finished. If not now, he's I think you agree, mate. Walks, the way he's changed the game with his leg speed and power and the amount of metres he creates is quite astonishing. And consistently, yeah, and does it consistently.
He does it. And the thing is, I've got him on the bench because he is consistent. And the thing is, I was going to put him in the starting lineup, but, I mean, when he comes off and he comes back onto the field and there's a few little tired forwards and a few tired edge defenders, his meters gain go up tenfold, and I love watching him play. There's a certain number of players in the competition at the moment. If I see two teams playing and I'm not really interested in watching, I won't watch. But if I know that there's a player, Dylan Brown and Moses, Mitchell Moses for Parramatta, I'm really enjoying the way that they play because they play a little bit off cuff and they're very skillful. So I'll always sit down and watch Parramatta play because of those guys. And Jason Taumalolo, he's one of those guys. If I know that the Cowboys are playing, I'll watch him.
Hey, Walks, how would you like to have tackled him? I'm just so happy I'm retired. Imagine that running at you.
Well, Finch, you know my tackling. I never
Yeah, me too.
I live by the rule: if 12 other players can't tackle,
well, yeah. I really hate him when the game changed and the halfback couldn't defend in the second line. I was really disappointed when that.
Hey, the last one I want to talk about here, boys. I think this one just comes down to state bias, because at halfback in your Legends team of the last 40 years, Finchie, you've got at halfback, you've got Andrew Johns, but Walks, you've got Alfie Langer.
Oh, mate, the reason why I got Alfie, I love Andrew Johns. I love Andrew Johns, but every time there was a team announced and Andrew, it was a choice between Andrew and Alf. Alf used to get the nod. I know that Alf was a lot older than Joey and, probably deserved his position, but every time they played against each other, Elf would usually get the chocolate. So, that's wholly and solely the only reason that I've got Elf in front of Joey.
Elfie, and again, it's a bit like I got JT on the bench, Jonathan Thurston. Like, it's splitting hairs when you're talking about these great players.
That's right.
I come from Newcastle, but I loved Alfie. Walks knows I was a huge Broncos fan growing up, and I loved Alfie Langer. And I remember seeing him at a RSL once in Canberra, and I got him to sign the schooner glass he was drinking out of. So. But I loved him. You talk about champions of the game. He was an absolute champion. The consistency he played with at the Broncos over a long period of time, and then obviously had that great Origin game. And Walks was right. A lot of times when they played the Knights, or especially during those Origin games, he was certainly the man and got the better of Joey those times. But when you talk about those great players, there's nothing between them,
Yeah. Hey.
Just on naming my team, it was really difficult to pick a position for any reason over someone else. I mean,
for me, it was really difficult to put Joey in above me at halfback, but I thought I'd better do it.
Well, Israel Folau and Dylan Slater took over the wing positions in front of me, so it was tough.
Mate, it's so good to catch up with you, Chris. I spend a lot of time on the Goldie. I'll look you up next time I'm there. But
Mate, the strip clubs aren't in near where Walks are, bro, so you won't see.
Good on you, mate. Good to catch up with you.
All right, cheers, boys. Thanks for having
Thanks,
me.
Thanks, Texas.
Good on you, mate. There he is, Chris Walker, another legend of league, joining us on our Legends of League podcast. And make sure you watch us every week. And remember, you can support the podcast by getting yourself into the Four Pines. We're at the Four Pines Brewhouse in Manly, and today we are going to try the Indian Summer Ale. You'd have one of those, wouldn't you, Finchy?
Yeah, I would, but my missus is here with me. Yeah. That's why I made sure I got home on time.
One six-pack, not one. Yeah. Well, there it is, another episode, and thank you so much for your support. Thanks to our partners, too. I've been right behind us. Four Pines Brewing Company, where we film our podcast here at Four Pines Brewhouse in Manly. We hope you'll give it a try. Give them a follow on social media, too. That would help. The handle, at Four Pines Beer, or check out their website, fourpinesbeer.com.au. That's the number four. And make sure that you press the subscription button to be the first to find out when we release a new episode. And, of course, you can stay up to date with all our latest announcements and content, social media at Legends of League AUS. That's at Legends of League AUS. See you next time on our Legends of League podcast.